morning and welcome. Jesus says, I am the way.
And so they follow him as his disciples.
Jesus says, I am the truth.
And so they place our trust in me.
Jesus says, I am the life.
And so they believe in the miracle of resurrection.
Thank you.
who have given us mind and love. Pray that we may show them respect and love. Fathers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope, and their family and friends support and console them, we pray to the Lord. For men, though without children of their own, like fathers have nurtured and cared for us, we pray to the Lord. Fathers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to their children and have not sustained their families, we pray God, our Father, in your wisdom of love, you made all things. Bless these men, that they may be strengthened as Christian followers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Share responsibly in Scripture, beginning with the 32nd Psalm. It is number 766 in the back of our hymnals. We will share it responsibly and share the sum response that is before us. First, we pray. Lord, out of your love for us, your desire to save us, you speak your word. This word comes to us now. May we open our ears, our hearts, to receive your gift. Salvation made known through the proclamation of your word. Amen. Whose sin heart that pures gold. E is for her eyes with love light shining. R means right, and right shall always be. Who called together they still? Mother. Okay. A word that means the world. Well, that's wonderful. Wonderful that we remember our mothers that way. But I'm thinking as a father, I don't have a song. And that's not right. Fathers should have songs too, right? Right? Help me out here. Okay, so we're going to have a father song, and we're going to spell out the word father, okay? And we're going to be spontaneous. We're going to improvise. In other words, we're going to make it up as we go, okay? So just as we spell out mother with M-O-T-H-E-R, we're going to do that with father. So the first letter in father would be F. Let's find an F. We don't need your help here. Who would like? There we go. So, just as M stands for something, that is going to stand for something too regarding fathers, okay? So, as you think of that, what could F stand for? Forgiving. Very good, Hudson. Fathers are forgiving. They're fun. Okay, so, Brady, you got the F, which means you're going to need to stand up. So, we're going to spell out our word here. Next will be the letter. Oh, yeah, we've got one first. A. And as we think of dad, father, A is going to stand.
Amazing.
All right, very good. A is amazing. Fathers are forgiving, they're amazing. And then our next letter would be?
T.
T. T would be? Trusting. Terrific. Okay. So we've got forgiving, we've got amazing. What do we have? Terrific. Trusting. Thank you. So our next letter is going to be H. All right. Here we go. Helpful. Okay. Holding. Honest. So we've got some wonderful words going on here. So we've got F, A, T, H. Kind of like the Hebrew, you read from right to left. You've got, what's next? E, all right. So E is, if we think of that, E is excellent. Excellent, okay.
Excellent.
All right, thank you. So we've got fun, forgetting, we've got amazing, trusting, honest, empty, excellent. So that means the one letter. That letter would be, well, it's not the R. So, R would be righteous.
Thank you.
When he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe. Put it on. Put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat and make merry. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. He began to make merry. Now his elder son was in the field. As he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what this meant. And he said to him, your brother has come and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him safe and sound. But he was angry, refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, lo, these many years I have served you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a kid that I might make merry with my friends, but when this son of yours came, who has devoured your living with harlots, you killed for him the fatted calf. He said to his son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to make merry and be glad. This your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. This is the word of our Lord. Was you and I worship this morning in Martinsville, United Methodist clergy and laity are concluding the latest session of annual conference in Roanoke. The final event of this conference is a service of worship in which the appointments of the coming year are fixed. Yes, that's the language of the conference. We're going to fix the appointments for the coming year. So this means that everyone at the Berglund Center in Roanoke is all excited to receive the latest edition of the Virginia Advocate. You may have seen, this is not the latest edition, but I expect it will be in our mailbox tomorrow morning. The latest edition of the Virginia Advocate, it's the monthly publication of this conference, which in this latest issue will list the appointments of all the pastors in the Virginia Conference. So members of the conference, both laity and clergy, upon receiving the Advocate this morning, will anxiously thumb through its pages, wanting to see what pastors are moving and what churches are receiving new pastors. And I confess, I'll be curious to see what changes are made this year as well. Curious to see where certain of my colleagues are appointed to serve. So looking at the Advocate, there will be many who will respond to certain appointments with surprise. Well, I didn't know she was going to move. She hadn't been in her church that long. Or is he coming back to the church for the 16th year? What's that like? So she is receiving another appointment. I know they're going to miss her. They loved her at her church. These are some of the responses that will be offered by many upon opening this latest issue of the Advocate. I share with you this. Another response will be offered today as well, a response perhaps unique to us clergy. It is not a response that flatters anyone, certainly not those called to Christian ministry. I suspect it is a response that's not pleasing to any of us, a response we wish we could be rid of. This response of anger, bitterness, jealousy. Now, why in the name of everything holy would any of us offer to the appointment of pastors this response of anger, bitterness, jealousy? And let me be quick to clarify, I'm sure not everyone offers so ugly a response to the listing of pastoral appointments. Yet I'm not wrong in naming that there are many among us who do that. But why such an ugly response? Because certain ones among us will look at this list of appointments, see the name of a colleague receiving an appointment to the prestigious church with a large staff and a big increase in salary, and we wonder, how did this happen? I've known this guy since seminary, and believe me, he's nothing special. Lord, we look at the appointments. See that a friend with whom we came into ministry is now a district superintendent. We look at this and think, wait a minute. Here I am slaving away at local churches and God knows where. For how many years I've done everything that's been asked of me. I've paid my dues. I should be a district superintendent for this guy. Or we see that a colleague is being appointed to start a new church. In a fast-growing part of a conference, he's presented as the poster boy for new churches and church growth. We see this and respond, him? The response, again, bitterness, anger, jealousy. No, not a flattering, honorable response, but honest, real. But why? Why so easily align ourselves at this time with the elder brother of the story Jesus tells this morning? Now I confess, this is not the direction that I wish to go with this scripture. I struggle in doing so, and this being Father's Day only accentuates the struggle. Because there are other, more pleasing directions I wish to be pulled in by Luke chapter 15. Such as with the sentiments that are expressed by the late Dutch Catholic priest, Henry Nouwen. Upon seeing a poster of Rembrandt's painting, The Return of the Prodigal Son, Nouwen was so moved. He traveled to the museum in which this painting is kept, and after several days of reflecting upon this painting, Nouwen was moved to write a book of the same name, in which he is moved to write, I had to kneel before the Father, put my ear against his chest, and listen, without interruption, the heartbeat of God. Powerful words. Words directing me to take in this work of art. But as I look at the painting produced by Rembrandt in the 1660s, I find that it shows not only the father and the younger son, but note there are others as well who look upon this scene, others who appear not to share in the father's ecstasy of the younger son. They appear to wonder, in fact, about the behavior of his father. Nonetheless, you and I look at the painting, and we are drawn to the figures on the left. The father welcoming, receiving the son, kneeling in humility and repentance. Who among us can look upon this scene and not be moved? Who among us does not wish to linger at this place and take to ourselves this scene of grace, reconciliation, all gathered here where the Father assures the Son, all things are made new? Who doesn't wish to stand there? That's where I want to stay. And this place, touching those places in the heart so sensitive to our hunger for healing, blessing, the desire of everyone in this room to feel the hands of God upon our shoulders. I want to stay there, draw the curtain, now leave the place dabbing the tears from our eyes. But I can't do that. I can't stay here and be faithful to this story, to our story. For as moving as this scene is, it's not the end of the story, is it? And the truth is, despite its power, the entirety of our story is still not found within that scene. Because we see the older brother standing to the right, hands crossed, disapproving. He said the story from the beginning. A man had two sons. And as much as we see ourselves attracted to the younger son, draped in grace and forgiveness, this witness of Scripture knows we are never far from this older brother, angry at the grace shown by God to those we say are unworthy. This isn't the only instance in which this bitter attitude of the older brother is shown in Scripture. Even a cursory overview of the Bible shows us that the attitude of the older brother is not unique to him. It's an experience that is present from the earliest days of our faith. God creates man and woman in his image, sets them in the garden, provided all they need. Still, they choose their will over God's. They're driven from the garden. In exile, they have two sons. Unable to accept God's favor shown the elder, the younger son Cain kills. The patriarch of God's people, Jacob, will have a number of sons, the youngest named Joseph. Joseph would in time receive the favor of his father, Jacob. Angry at the favor Joseph receives from the father, Joseph's older brothers conspire to fake the death of Joseph so as to be rid of him. God's people wanting a king are given a king. King's name is Saul. Saul reigns many years, defeats many people, enemies of Israel. Yet Saul becomes totally unhinged as he sees God's favor rest upon a man named David. Driven by jealousy, Saul seeks to destroy David, manages only to destroy himself. As for Jonah, the man chosen by God to save the people of Nineveh, he wants nothing to do with God's favor poured upon a people so undeserving, and when God's favor is shown Nineveh, there's no person more miserable than Jonah. Are we seeing this theme? A theme surfacing in this story in which a father who had two sons. It's a theme central to Scripture, and as much as I wish I could stop this story prematurely, and say with the embrace of the loving father and lost son now found, I can't stop here and be faithful to Scripture. Man had two sons. And the story can't be told any other way. To tell the story focusing only on the younger cuts our faith story in half. For though we celebrate the return of the younger, wish to claim this loving embrace of the father, that's not our only experience of faith. For to be honest about and faithful to our experience of faith, we find we must also confess this. We have won the glory, and we have crossed our hands in judgment, just like the older brother of this man who had two sons. Like us clergy, critically scanning the pages of the latest issue of the Advocate, we have all questioned favors shown to those we believe undeserving. We have believed ourselves slighted by grace shown to those unlike us. We have resented the blessing shown those we believe less deserving. As we have done so, we have missed the message central to this parable. The man who had two sons holds the same love, the same grace, the same favor for us older sons and daughters. In his love for the younger, the father withholds nothing from us. Despite the grace shown the younger, you and I are cheated nothing. And in our nurturing and feeding of resentment and bitterness and jealousy, we fail to see the Father's extraordinary
had love for us.
And there now and again captures this truth as he writes again in his book. Rembrandt is as much the elder son of the parable as he is the younger. When during the last years of his life he painted both sons in his Return of the Prodigal Son, he had lived a life in which neither the lostness of the younger son nor the lostness of the elder son was alien to him. Both needed healing and forgiveness. Both needed to come home. Both needed the embrace of a loving father. But from the story itself, as well as from Rembrandt's painting, it is clear that the hardest conversion to go through is the conversion of the one who stayed home. Remember that the father divided his living between both the elder and younger. Remember that the father came to the elder, wanting him to share in the celebration for the return of his brother. Remember the father's declaration to the elder, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours." You see, the father's love for the younger deprives us of nothing. God deprives you and me of nothing simply because he lives according to his desire to save and heal all he has made, even the younger son. We clergy would do well to see this as we scan the list of the appointments. We all would do well to see this as we examine the experiences of our lives. Because even now we can touch those experiences in which we wish God was not so gracious to those we believe less worthy of us. Well, in the meantime, in this in between time, we are still invited to allow God's Spirit to lead us to that holy place where, without hesitation, we celebrate the love of God for all. From this place, we are invited to find ourselves rejoicing in the unceasing desire of God, place his hands of blessing upon the shoulders of all he has made. You may remain seated. Prayer of intercession.
Find our way.
Yes, Lord.
responsibly in the prayers of the people. As we do so, we will be mindful of the conclusion of any of the times.
My mom and I have been working on the flowers in the breezeway for 5 years, and the air conditioning is broken. And the flowers will not live another 2 weeks without air conditioning in that breezeway. The other breezeway is too small, and I feel like somewhere, somehow, God will see that air conditioning is fixed. But if it's not fixed, I'll have 3 different flowers. And I know you all love them. And so please pray for this, because I've carried on for what my mother started, and I intend to carry on until it's finished. So please help us find a way to fix those air conditioners. Thank you.
Remember the conclusion and conference of the program. And we also remember certainly our brothers and sisters in Protestant and members of the church. We'll share these petitions. I will conclude with the Lord in mercy. Invite me to respond to your own.
Pastors and families that are moving to new homes and new churches.
Lord,